Hi, folks. My name is Bill Cook. If you've ever attended one of our real estate investing seminars, then you've heard me mention Jack Miller's name often. My admiration for the man is boundless. My gratitude for all that he's taught, immeasurable. Many people ask me, what was Jack like? They didn't get a chance to meet him in person or see him teach. Prentice Yates, my good friend, recently sent me a package in the mail, and in it was some video footage of Jack. It's classic. So if you really want to know what Jack was like or a little bit about what Jack was about, watch. Watch what comes next. You're in for a real treat. And if you want to learn more about Jack, earlier this year, Jackie Lang gave control of Cashflow Depot over to us. And at cashflowdepot.com, you will find a lot of Jack's teaching information. Pay particular attention to his Commonwealth newsletters. That was a monthly newsletter he put out for decades. Phenomenal thinking, phenomenal investor, great deal maker. Y'all stay tuned. Enjoy Jack Miller.
We're going to tell some secrets at this session of Real Estate Roundtable. We're going to tell probably the best kept secret of all in the field of real estate and talk about it and find out how you can share in that secret and use that secret to become wealthy. But we have a guest with us at this session who doesn't believe in secrets. He believes in sharing the wealth, sharing the secrets, and letting everybody have the benefit of learning how to use those secrets for their own benefits. Our guest with us at this session, to my right, a legend in his own time, a mentor for heaven knows how many folks, an entrepreneur, was a broker. I don't even know if Jack is still a broker, but I know that he knows all there is to know about real estate, and more than that, he shares it. Good to have you with us tonight.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure.
Sure.
Share the wealth.
You know, the most powerful thing that I've ever discovered in really, really making a quantum leap in real estate fortunes is the use of options. And we hear people say lease option like it's one word.
What is an option?
Well, an option is a right to withdraw from a contract, basically. If you're going to buy a property, it's the right to set the price, set the terms, set a date of closing sometime in the future, usually longer than shorter, and then decide after you've had a chance to check the rest of the market and to check the cost of financing whether or not you want to complete the transaction. If you don't want to complete it, you don't have to. If you do want to complete it, you can go ahead.
What's the advantage of doing it with an option rather than just doing your research first?
Well, it doesn't work that way. For example, let's make a presumption everybody wants to buy a bargain, wants to buy a good deal. Mm-hmm. And the good deals last about a half a day. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you remember here in San Diego, but in 1978 or so, the lifespan of an average listing was under a half a day. That's when you're getting 3% per month appreciation in values here.
Do you think that we'll see that again?
Oh, sure we will. You know, everything goes in cycles. Everything goes in cycles.
Sure.
If you can find something to go in a straight line, we'd all jump on it, but nothing in nature goes in a straight line. And probably the overwhelming attribute you should have to make money in real estate is patience. Just to wait for the cycle. It'll save you every time. All the politicians and all the king's horses and all the king's men can't stop that business cycle from doing what it does. And things go up for a while, and then they go down for a while.
I tell people that when I was a kid, I was one of those little pills. You know, one of those little pills? I was a miser. I never spent my lunch money. I gambled it. I made a little, and I'm in second grade. I made a little box out of paper, folded paper, with a little hole in it. And if you could shoot your marble through that little hole, then I gave you 5 marbles. But if you couldn't shoot through that little hole, I took your marble. It's a simple little game, right? The hole was smaller than the marbles. Well, you know, I had this big monster bag of marbles going around selling people to play in my game. I was eight, you know, I was a slow learner. But I've always enjoyed the game. And so a little later on, my mother used to give me a hammer. And she'd sit me down by, we were a poor family that had no toys, give me a brick and a hammer by an ant nest. And the ant would go across the brick, I'd go splat, splat, splat. Well, that got boring after a while, so I got an electric socket. And they'd crawl across the electric socket, go zap, zap. Then I put them in a jug and I drowned them. See, I was one of those strange little kids. I saved my money up and I bought a baseball. I pitched, I batted, I caught, I played any position I wanted to, any time. If you didn't want to play with my rules, I took my ball and went home. Nothing's changed. I'm the same guy.
How many people here know somebody who has some cash that doesn't know what to do with it? Yeah. It's hard to figure it out. It really is. Put in the stock market, it goes zip-de-doo-dah every day. You don't know what you're doing in the stock market or why. And you put it in gold. Gold's at the highest it's ever been. You want to buy now at the top of the highest it's ever been? No, I don't want to buy gold. Short gold. Euros, that's the thing. It is the thing. You don't know to do the silly money. The banks are all lying through the teeth. You don't know who's got what. You know who's solvent, who's not solvent. You want to put it, dig a hole in the backyard, put it there. I literally know a guy did that. I literally know a guy. I just spent some time with him on this trip in the last 2 weeks. He put $2 million in little Ziploc bags all over his backyard, $100 bills. Now, went out at night, dug little divots up, put them in, patted them down, put them in. Now, guess what he did the rest of his time? Worried about somebody finding this $2 million. So he worried about it and worried about it and worried about it. So after about a year, he went and dug it all up again, had a little chart, you know, X marks the spot, a little pirate map, you know. And so he dug up the first one. All the money is all green and moldy because the Ziploc bags didn't quite seal it. Moisture's all wrinkly looking. Now this is a guy worth $100 million. He's out in his living room and his kitchen at night with a shade drawn with an ironing board, ironing his money. So he can turn it into the bank and get it turned in for new money. It's hard. This is tough, yeah. This is tough. It ain't easy being rich. And
what's insurance about? It's fear factor. They're trying to scare you into thinking the tornado's going to hit your house. House is 40 years old, has never been hit by a tornado before. It's going to hit it now as soon as you own it. Don't worry about insurance. Go through them fast. You worry about liability, don't own it in your name. Own it in an entity that has no other asset than that house. Don't let things hang you up if you're moving through things fast. I'm trying to think of an analogy. You ever rent a rental car? Don't they try to sell you every piece of insurance in the world because, and they try to scare you only $9 more a day. But how many times you ever wreck your rental car? And so so I got a rental car out there. I didn't take the insurance. Said one driver, yeah, because $5 for each driver. Yeah, one driver. I loaned it to three people so far today, driving all over the county. Don't let people scare you. Don't be afraid. Don't be a fraidy cat. You know, we're entrepreneurs. We seize our destiny. Caveat, what'd I say? Per diem, seize the day. Yeah, compre diem. Yeah, just grab your future and shake it like this. It's my future. Don't let people fool you. Don't let people scare you. What to be scared of? You lose a little money, big damn deal, make some more, you know. comps, what in the world a comp is in MLS? It's hope. I mean, MLS is a prayer book. It's a prayer book. It's the aspirations of a whole bunch of brokers, not homeowners, a bunch of brokers trying to get a big commission, bigger price, bigger commission. It's just a prayer book. That means it has nothing for anything. You want comps, go get the ones that sold. Go get that little listing courthouse to put out about the sales. But that's not even right either, because that's historical data. In a climbing market, that's great. In a falling market, it's bad. The comps are bad. They're automatically high in a falling market. So I don't go near that stuff. You know what I use for comps? I'm on the street all the time. I'm talking to people all the time about their houses, about what they want. My comps are me. My money, my comps. I'm betting my money on what I think something's worth. And, you know, if you stay on the street, you don't need to ask anybody else what something's worth. You know what it's worth. You're on the street all the time. Just be active in the business. You don't need all that other stuff. But if you're going to be a dilettante, sit there and say, I think I'll have a little dessert deal. I'll have my house. You need all the help you can get. I just did a course in 3 weeks ago here on a different hotel, explaining to people what the word mortgage means, because there are a lot of people didn't know what it meant. It's a basic class. What a deed does. Peter Fortunato and I were making a deal with a guy who's a nationally known investment advisor, PhD, economist, blah, blah, blah. So we made him this deal. And so a year or two later, we sat down with him and we're having supper or lunch or something in a restaurant. He says, hey, when do I get my title? Do I get it from the state or what? Title to what? Well, title that property you gave me. Well, we gave you a deed. Yeah, but don't I get a title like a car? No, you get a deed. Oh, you mean that piece of paper is important? Yeah. Oh. What am I supposed to do? Well, you might want to take it out and record it. That'd be a start. He didn't understand. And you know, as a PhD, you're not allowed to ask. You know, once you're a PhD, you can't ask any more questions. You know, in education, I spent 26 and a half years in public in formal education. I was a slow learner. And I didn't have enough sense to quit. And you learn that the farther you go in school, you specialize. So you learn more and more and more about less and less and less. And you finally get to be a PhD and you learn all there is to know about nothing. Try to make friends with everybody as you go through life. Don't leave enemies behind you. And you don't have to give them high prices. You don't have to give them compliments. But you got to tell them what you are. I say, be careful, watch me. I'm a thief. I can't help myself. I'm a klepto. I'm a perfect guy. I got one tiny little flaw. I'm greedy. One tiny little flaw. And if we can overlook that one little flaw of mine, I'm a wonderful person. See? And you gotta say, look, I can't pay you what you want. I said, I'm not Santa Claus. I can't give you gifts. I'm not your tooth fairy. I don't take wishes. I gotta work in the real world, and I can't pay you any more than I can make on it. And if you don't want me to make a living, just say, I don't want you to feed your children, Jack. Don't make a living. Get on welfare. But pay me retail. Just spit it right out. If you don't want me to make a living, say so. And if you do want me to make a living, say a better price so I can make a living here. You know, I got to make a living here. And just talk to people like that. They don't really get mad. Don't lie to them. Don't deceive them. Don't ever make a promise you're not going to keep. So don't make a promise, in other words. I don't let people dictate paperwork to me in any situation, buying or selling. It's going to be my paperwork or we're not going to make a deal. Simply because I don't want to read yours. Isn't that easy? I know exactly what's in mine. I don't know what's in yours. I don't want to take any time reading it. It's my, well, our board of directors, our board of realtors, isn't that the pits? Why don't you quit? I'm not going to fool your board of realtors. I'm not a member of your board of realtors. Well, our bar association, well, ain't that the pits? How much are you going to pay for your house? Unless they're buying your house, let's don't talk about them. Let's talk about me. Got wampum, one house. You don't want to stop having your real estate support you at any point in your future when you don't want to or you can't work. You don't want to notch that lifestyle down one notch. You want it right there. And that's the number you can come up, and only you can come up with that number. Nobody else can do it. But when you find that number, write it down. And then I implore you, when you finally find that number, and you finally reach that number, quit and walk away. That's the hardest thing you're going to do. Hardest thing in the world is to walk away from a business that produces a lot of money, effortlessly now at this point, and just walk away. And if you do walk away and you find out there's a whole hole in your life now because all the fun you had going out biting people in the neck is all gone now. So I started closing on contracts no one signed. Nobody noticed. It's a riot. You fax a contract to the closing company, do the papers, anything like this, so forth, and we close, nobody signs on the contract. It's a riot. You realize after all, half the stuff you do in the real estate business is some square dance that somebody put your little foot here, put your little foot there, has nothing to do with the deal. Nothing to do with the deal. Has something to do with some tribal rights somebody thought up in 1493 and they've kept them ever since.
Just the big hangout, they tell me, for cowboys in Houston. But how many cowboys are actually in there? And what even makes a cowboy? Let's go in and find out. So what makes a real cowboy?
I guess the way he rides.
The way he rides what?
Depends on what he's riding.
Oh, really? So you like cowboys?
My brother's a bull rider. He's a cowboy.
Have you ever gone out with a non-cowboy?
Yeah.
No good?
We call them suits.
Call them suits. You don't like suits? Listen to suit.
But you wear a suit most of the time.
Oh, yeah, well, I'm not bull riding, yeah. Now, sir, you look conspicuous. You're like the only non-cowboy here.
I think I'm lost.
Would your plane get lost coming in from New York?
They tell me to turn left, I turn right.
Now, do you find wearing a suit and tie, is it hard to beat women here?
Real hard. Yeah. Real hard.
Come fly with me. Let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's float down to Peru. In Lama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide, starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear the angels cheer, because we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. Just say the words and we'll beat those birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. So come fly with me, let's fly away. Oh, come on and fly. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear all the angels cheer, because we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. You just say those words and we'll beat those birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's so perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly, let's fly. Pack up, let's fly.
Strange, it's dangerous. And it takes a whole bunch of gumption to do it the first time and get it done. And no one will be there to hold your hand. You'll be all on your own. And you say, what do you say about that? And that's really going to separate you from the winners to the losers. Because there are people, some people, that really down at the bottom, they want a safe journey. And some people that are meat eaters, they want to take them on the world. So they're kind of like the oyster and the eagle. Oyster is a very simple bivalve. This is on the bottom of the ocean, usually warm water, comfortable. It's full of nutrients, plankton, things like this. Anytime an oyster is hungry, it opens its mouth. Something washes in, clamps down on it. If you can't stand it, spits it out. If you want to hang on to it, turns it into a pearl. Oysters don't have ears, nobody talks to them. Don't have eyes, nothing to see. No feet, they're not going anywhere, no reason to go anywhere. And we checked with National Geographic. They said in all the history of the world, they've never found evidence whatsoever of an oyster ever starving to death. They seem to do just fine by just being oysters, just do great. And eagles are the opposite end of the spectrum. They're coming back now, but you know, they've always represented more than just a bird. They've represented courage and freedom and spirit, national symbol. Indians grabbed their tail feathers, stuck them in their heads. But we can't stand eagles. We have to protect them with federal law. We can't stand anybody that's got that attitude. We shoot them the first chance we get. So they live way apart from people up on top of pine trees and mountains and things. And the eagle, for him to get through life, he has to get up every morning and launch himself out over the abyss and look down and try and find something he can run down and catch and kill and haul home. And he never knows from day to day if he's going to make it. But somehow he does, and the National Geographic study eagles, so they seem to get along just fine. You know, they except for DDT or things like that, they manage to catch food every day, and they make it all the way through their life, and they don't starve to death either. So think about it. You have choices here. You have choices whether you want to be an oyster, have a nice, comfortable, quiet life. It'll be fine. It'll be okay, calm, peaceful, serene. Or you want to be an eagle, that has perfect freedom to go any place you want to go, do anything you want to do, eat what you want to eat when you can catch it, catch anything you can, and nobody can tell you what to do, and your life belongs to you. So whether you're an oyster or an eagle, you have a choice. But reflect on one thing. Almost every town in every state will sooner or later serve you a fried oyster. None of them serve you a fried eagle. Thank you for coming. Thank you.